Hi students, this is Ram Mohan, JLN History, Government Junior College, Kachiguda. Today, in our second year history, Qutub Shahi administration. In our previous class, we studied the political history of Qutub Shahis. Now, we are going to learn Qutub Shahi dynasties. Administration. As you know, the Qutub Shahi rulers since 1518 to 1687, during these years, we observed their administration was based on absolute monarchy and the divine right. Starting from Sultan Quli Qutb al-Mulk, who started or who was the founder of Qutb Shahi dynasty, later Jamshid, who started his career after killing his own father from 1543 to 1550. The third one, Subhan Quli, he did not get any importance, of course, because he was a small child. 1550 to 1580. This was the golden era of Qutb Shahi dynasty. Here, Ibrahim Quli Qutb Shah, he was the great sultan of the entire Qutb Shahi dynasty. So, during his reign, the Qutb Shahi dynasty reached here the extreme stage, the zenith stage in all corners. From 1580 to 1612, Muhammad Quli Qutb Shah, who was the founder of Hyderabad as well as Charminar. And later 1612 to 1626, Sultan Muhammad Quli Qutb Shah. From this onwards, Mughal invasions started and the Golconda kingdom, the Qutb Shahi kingdom also declined gradually. So after Abdullah Qutb Shah, Abul Hasan Thani Shah was the last ruler when it was a witness of the complete Mughal domination, Mughal interference, later the decline of Qutb Shahi dynasty, and Mughals occupied the entire Golconda kingdom in 1687 after defeating and killing the last ruler, Abul Hasan Thani Shah. So, here you observed the entire Golconda kingdom. The Qutb Shahi rulers here maintain good bilateral relations with other kingdoms like Ahmedabad, Bijapur. In south side you observed Vijayanagara Empire also. So you see Jamshid, when he killed his own father, Ibrahim Quli Qutb Shah went to Vijayanagara and took asylum, okay, under Aliya Ramaraya and Sadashivaraya. So here, they maintained a good relation since they founded the kingdom. So later, when Ibrahim Quli Qutb Shah occupied the throne of Golconda, then not only maintaining relations here, he strengthened the relations by marrying, okay, different women, and he married his own sister to different kingdoms also. Like that, he empowered the Golconda Sultanate. Later, he defeated Vijayanagara kingdom after merging or combined force of his Deccan Sultans in Tallikota or Rakshasa Thangadi War, which was occurred in 1565. So, it was a great and event during this Sultanate, Golconda Sultanate period, that is the Rakshasa Thangadi battle. So anyhow, when you start Quli Qutb Shah's administration, so now you see we are recollecting here the sound and popular administration of the Bahmani kingdoms, the other Deccani Sultanate. Even they followed here the Safavid rulers of Iran also. Okay. Because their ideology, firstly here, one is here, Bahmanis. Later, Secondly, ideology, Safavid ideology. So they practiced here, the Qutub Shahi rulers practiced there two ideology. Okay. One is the Deccani, another one is Safavid rulers of Iran. So Mirza Ibrahim Jubair's work, Basatin ul Salatin, this work gave information about Qutub Shahi dynasty. Not only that, even the entire Deccani kingdoms. Adil Shahi, Qutub Shahi kingdoms, their administration, their policies, their programs, everything we went through this book only. And of course, they maintained here the sound and popular administration. So that is the Qutub Shahi administration. And the administration had a great pillar, that is the theory of a divinity. Means the king is equal to the god, that is the Jil Allah, the shadow of the god. So the king is considered here the shadow of the god. So this kinship or this practice is called here theory of divinity. And here king was the head of the central administration. He exercised all powers. He was the chief responsible in all activities, though he maintained here a major council, that is the council of ministers. It is called Majlis-e-Divandari. Majlis-e-Divandari means a council of ministers. So this council always helped to the king or sultan in the administration, given advices, given suggestions, and helped in all directions. Here the important person among all ministers, of course, as you know, Peshwa and Mir Jumla are prime minister. Okay, already you know, king was the head of the center of the administration. So even though he was advised by Majlis-e-Divandari, among them here Peshwa, okay, Mir Jumla, prime minister, all are same. So he was the important person in administration after Sultan. And later you see Ainul Mulk, he was the minister of armed forces. He was the chief commander of forces. So when battle, any war, any conflict, any invasion was going on, first of all, the king gave information and communication to the Ainul Mulk. He was the head of the armed forces. Okay. Of course, king had here the powers over all organs like executive, legislature and judiciary. But even though these were separated, that's what Majumdar, the controller general of audit, Nazir, he was the in charge of general supervision, Dabir in charge, and Suravi is also record keeper. So different people here among all, okay, this Majlis-e-Divandari, each minister consists some powers. Okay. And Kotwal, the Kotwal was nothing but here civil officer, and Sarkil was the chief revenue officer over all provinces. Okay. Sarkil was the chief revenue officer, and Kotwal was the civil officer. He was the Hawaldar here. So it land order, especially during the conflicts, during the season of land order, he maintained completely. And record keeper also, one of the important ministers here, Srunavis. Okay. So like that, after Peshwa, after prime minister, different ministers, okay, always supervised here. These are all supervised by Peshwa or prime minister. So each and every responsibility was headed by these ministers. And Mir Jumla, the finance minister after Peshwa, Ainul Mulk, as you know, military officer. Okay. Total 12 wazirs were appointed here, and each wazir was given jagirs, okay, in return salaries. And Majumdar was the chief accountant. Okay. He always record keeper, all accounts he maintained in central administration. Okay. We are discussing here central administration after Sultan, Peshwa, of course, Divan, Mir Jumla, finance minister, Ainul Mulk, and Dabir, later Nazir, Majumdar, Srinivas, they are all important ministers here who were occupied in Majlis-e-Divandari. So while writing in central government, central administration, you have to write the all ministers' names and their responsibilities also. Okay, once you see here, Mir Jumla, the finance minister, Ainul Mulk in charge of military, and 12 wazirs helped to the ministers here, and all wazirs here provided here only jagirs. Now moving to provincial administration. Okay, after central administration, now we are discussing provincial administration. Here the kingdom was divided into tarafs or provinces. So nowadays the entire country, you know, divided into states, districts. Okay, like that, during the Qutub Shahi dynasty, the entire Qutub Shahi kingdom was divided into different tarafs. These tarafs were called here provinces. So each province or each taraf, okay, and headed by taraf is called tarafdar. So tarafdar was the head of the taraf, and 6 tarafs, 37 sarkars, and 517 pargana. Okay, during the last Qutub Shahi ruler Abul Hasan Tanisha, he was the last ruler. During his reign, 6 tarafs, total Qutub Shahi kingdom was divided into 6 tarafs. These 6 tarafs were headed by 6 tarafs there. 6 tarafs divided into different sarkars. So here 37 sarkars, Qutub Shahi maintains 37 sarkars, and sarkars again here divided into parganas. So kingdom, Qutub Shahi kingdom divided into tarafs, tarafs divided into sarkars, sarkars divided into parganas, and parganas consist here number of villages. So village is the basic unit of administration. So above village paragana, above paragana sarkar, above sarkar here tarafs, okay, and that is last kingdom. The sultanate, okay, the administration was completely in the hand of the royal family, royal noble families only. So the important post, the important ministries were given, okay, to the only royal members. The chief port officer here in provinces area, you see Shah Bandar. So chief port officer, of course the powerful Avaldars maintained here ports like Machilipatnam, Motupalli. These are the important ports of Qutub Shahi dynasty. So these forts were headed by the powerful Havaldars. Above Havaldars, one more supervisor here, that is chief port officer. He was named as here Shah Bandar. Shah Bandar was the chief port officer. Shah Bandar was the chief port officer. Example here, see the Karnataka province. He are headed by the experienced and loyal officials. So you are loyal, it should be at a time they should be very experienced. So only experienced persons, officials only here allotted, okay, to the different provinces. And the provincial administration or tarafdar, province or tarafdar, both are same, and each taraf was maintained by tarafdar or headed by tarafdar, and later all tarafs divided into sarkars. Now you see these sarkars were called simi. You see Rayala Seema, Vinikonda Seema, Bellankonda Seema, Machilipatnam, Eluru, Rajamundri, they're all nowadays they are the towns or cities, but during the Qutub Shahi dynasty these places are called as simis. So the sarkars were called as simi, nothing but a district, the present district, okay, in Qutub Shahi dynasty we can call a simi. Example, already you know Bellamkonda, Vinukonda, okay, these important places like Eluru, Rajamundri, Machilipatnam, these places called simis. And here you observed like Majlis-e-Divandari in central administration, in sarkars also Deshpande, Tanedar, Deshmukh, Majumdar, these are the important persons. So, who looked after here? The entire Sarkar's administration. So, Deshpande, Tanedar, Deshmukh and Majumdar. These people are very, very important during the administration, especially provincial administration. Coming into the revenue administration, of course, as you guess, land revenue was the important source of any kingdom. Here, Sarkar was taken a basic unit in while considering land revenue. Okay, coming into administration, village was a basic unit. But here, revenue administration, they consider each Sarkar was taken as a unit. To fix land revenue, they took here, Sarkar was the basic unit, and later they granted to highest bidder, the power to collect the land revenue, to collect the taxes from the people, the highest bidder only was granted, through the method of auction. Through the method of auction only, they provided the grants, the powers to the highest bidder. And of course, because of this, the burden on farmers had increased here. So land revenue was very high. They collected more tax compared to other sultans. But though burden was very hard or very later increased also, but even though there was no great burden because the facilities provided by the sultans, the different tanks, different dams, different water irrigation facilities, when they provided, so of course they increased the tax in return. So burden on farmers had increased here. So they take here, Sarkar is the basic unit. In coming into the villages also, they collected same tax here. But to collect the taxes here, again, they appointed here people like Majumdar, Deshpande. Now coming into the military administration. As you know, Bahmani sultans, Bahmani sultans were very powerful in Deccan area. When it was split into different kingdoms, Qutub Shahi followed, because it was founded in the remains of Bahmani sultans. So that the military administration, the central administration, same, whatever Bahmani sultan practiced here, what military administration was prevailed during their tenure, definitely Qutub Shahis also followed military administration of Bahmanis. And they followed here huge army, standing army. The founder of Qutub Shahis, as you know, Sultan Quli Qutub al-Mulk, he founded here a huge army. He strengthened his army because he wanted to defeat here other rulers to occupy Golconda. That's what he maintained, standing army, continued that. After that, Ibrahim Quli Qutub Shah, when he came to the throne of Qutub Shahi, he also maintained here and strengthened here his Golconda or Qutub Shahi's army. And he made, of course, Golconda as his capital in the founder Sultan Quli Qutub al-Mulk. And it was strengthened and it was well equipped by Ibrahim Quli Qutub Shah. So anyhow, moving to the military system here, the head of the military administration was Ain Ul Mulk. Ain Ul Mulk was the chief commander of all forces. He was the head of the armed forces. He was the head of the military administration. And Qutub Shahi army consists here not only Hindus and Muslims, even the migrated Iranians also, large people who migrated from Iranian, they settled here and they took over the jobs of different in administration. So that we can notice here Hindus and Muslims of in India, and later Iranians also joined hands. According to the French traveler Thévenot, the Qutub Shahi army consists here 8 lakhs, the soldiers 8 lakhs, 8 lakhs, 84,400. okay, and 77. 8,84,477. The number of military people, the number of soldiers, it was noticed in the records, the foreign record of Thevenot. Okay. And here they maintain a specific uniform, turban, armor, helmet, and shirt. These are the, okay, a specific uniform of the military people. Now, moving to the justice. As you know, Sultan exercised here all powers, legislature, executive, and judicial powers, even though he here appointed, okay, a few people to look after the judicial administration in provincial areas like sarkars, parganas, and villages. And the sultans practiced here justice by taking advice and decisions of a local Hindu dharma shastras, because the majority population here Hindu people. That's what, while disposing justice, okay, they have to take advice and decisions of local Hindu dharma shastras, the jurists, the heads of the villages. Here local dharma shastras or jurists played important role. And coming into Islam, the Muslim elders like qazis, maulvis, okay, and other scholars also played a key role in the administration of justice. Okay, and special arrangements have been made for protection of the goods of foreign traders also. So there was a great trade and business with foreign countries. That's what many people flowed into Qutub Shahi, Golconda kingdom. That's what, to protect the foreign travelers for their goods, special arrangements also taken by the Qutub Shahi rulers, and separate courts also set up by these rulers like Dad Mahal and Aman Mahal. These are the separate courts of Qutub Shahi dynasty. You see, the French traveler Thevenot said, Abdullah Qutub Shah, okay, Abdullah Qutub Shah was the great jurist. Okay, it indicated here that all sultans, okay, all Qutub Shahi sultans here had great knowledge here, okay, and they were great jurists also, according to the French traveler Thevenot. Now moving to the socio-cultural conditions. Okay, as you know, the Qutub Shahi supported or practiced here Persian language, Arabic language. Okay, these are the important languages, Persian and Arabic, and the court language, Persian language. But though this they encouraged here the local language Telugu also. Telugu really encouraged, supported in a great extent, not only one or two rulers. Since Sultan Quli Qutub al-Mulk onwards, Abul Hasan Tanisha, majority rulers, many rulers here supported, gave good encouragement, okay, to Telugu language. The foreign accounts also showed here, indicated here, the great support of Qutub Shahi dynasty, the Qutub Shahi rulers towards the Telugu language and literature. So here all languages are developed here, all languages are encouraged here, okay. So not only that, not only this vernacular languages here, even the foreign accounts, the foreign travelers who frequently visited here India, especially the Golconda kingdom, Tavernier, Bernier, Thevenot, William Method, these people also, okay, showed here information about the social and cultural conditions of the Qutub Shahi kingdom. Here maintained religious tolerance. Religious tolerance means already the people are, the rulers are here Islam, Muslims. Those they supported here Hindu, they showed here religious tolerance, they encouraged Hindu literature, Telugu literature, so that here religious tolerance prevailed during Qutub Shahi dynasty. They maintained equality between the Persian language and Telugu language also. So, and they encouraged here large number of migrations from Iran. So when Mir Mumin Astrabadi came to Hyderabad, okay, later he built Hyderabad, Charminar, like that, many people, okay, migrated to Hyderabad, migrated to Golconda. So this This incident year culminated popular and composed Hyderabad culture and extended literary support also. So, coming into social and cultural conditions here, see, all religions here practiced here, all religions here got good encouragement here, all languages also. That's what great literary work also we can notice here during the Qutub Shahi dynasty, Qutub Shahi rulers. Moving to the agriculture and irrigation, of course, agriculture was the chief occupation of the people. It was the primary occupation of the people. To support the agriculture, to increase the production of agriculture, definitely Kakatiya rulers also maintained here, okay, and restored here many tanks. They built many tanks, okay, many canals. Like that, Qutub Shahi rulers also great work they did here, irrigation canals. Many tanks they constructed, like Budhwell tank, Hussain Sagar tank, Ibrahim Patnam tank, okay, Durgu tank, which supplied to the water facility to the royal family of Golconda, and Hussain Sagar, the entire Hyderabad, the people, there was a great tank, that is Hussain Sagar. It gives a drinking water, okay. Later, Durgu tank and Masab tank, which was constructed by Hait Baksh Begum. These all tanks for water, drinking water facility. Later, okay, to increase the land, okay, to increase the agriculture production, the cultivation activity, okay, they dug many canals and many tanks. So here, because of the interest of Qutub Shahi dynasty, the rulers here, agriculture, okay, and irrigation also, okay, greatly achieved. Now moving to the trade and commerce. Okay, to know about the trade and commerce of Qutub Shahi dynasty, there are two important literary works here, gave lot of information about the their business, their contacts, okay, and their trade activities. They are Shuka Saptati and Hamsa Vimsati. These are the important books here showing information about the trade and commerce. Not only that, many travelers, foreign travelers in books, their works also showed here a great encouragement of the Qutub Shahis toward the trade and business. The French travelers Bernier, Thévenot and Travener, English trader Thomas Bory, okay, and these are the foreign accounts, foreign works also exhibited here, okay, their great support to the trade and commerce. Here, Vasumata and Vishnudasa, these are the two important names are given. These are the rich traders. These two people are rich traders during the Qutub Shahi dynasty. During this season, you can notice here Hyderabad, Warangal, Machilipatnam, Motupalli, Kondapur, Penugonda, Tirupati. These are the important cities, important towns of trade and commerce. Vemulawada, Gulbarga, Aurangabad, Tirupati, Ahobilam, Srishailam. These are the important cities as well as the tourist centers, pilgrimage centers of Qutub Shahi dynasty. And here, oxen, bullcarts and perikars carried the merchandise activity from place to place. Even the artisans and traders also migrated to where demanded, where a lot of demand is available, where the growth is available. Then the artisan traders migrated to one place to another place. And Kollur, Paritala, Ramallakota, Vajrakaru, these are the places of diamond mines, Nirmal and Indur, and even iron industry also find out here. Iron industry also developed here in Nirmal and Indur, and Narsapuram, Machilipatnam, these are the important ports of Qutub Shahi dynasty. Motupalli is the chief port center, especially the foreign traveler Thévenot, he gave information about the Kohinoor diamond, which was founded in the Kollur area, Kollur mines. The world famous Kohinoor diamond was available and noticed here. And Honnu was the chief coin, the gold coin of Qutub Shahi dynasty. Even the foreigners also described here Honnu as pagoda. They consider Honnu as pagoda. This is about the trade and commerce of